Hello, I'm Ty Mason of the DiabetesCouncil.com, researcher, writer, and I have type 2 diabetes. Today I want to talk about the glycemic index. After you watch the video today, I do invite you to check out the description box for my new ebook. This is one of the most comprehensive diabetes meal planning book you can find anywhere. It contains diabetes-friendly meals and recipes. Recipes for different goals such as 800 or 1800 calorie per day meal plans, diabetes meal planning tips and tricks. There are also tons and tons of diabetes friendly recipes for everyone. Let me state up front that while I believe the glycemic index is a very important tool for those of us with diabetes, I truly believe the glycemic load is a better tool. But the glycemic load uses the glycemic index in its calculation, therefore understanding the GI is also an important concept. To get the absolute best research material for this project, I will be quoting a lot of material from the official website of the International GI Database, which is hosted by the University of Sydney. That web address is www.glycemicindex.com. Now, this website is an extraordinary research tool with a plethora of information about the glycemic index, and I truly invite you to visit this site if you want to know more about this topic. But as I stated, all of my research was done on this extensive website. The glycemic index is a ranking of carbs on a scale from 0 to 100, according to the extent to which they raise blood sugar levels after eating. The ranking is as follows. Foods with a GI of 55 or less is considered a low GI food. Foods with a GI of 56 to 69 is a medium GI food, and foods with a GI of 70 or higher is a high GI food. Now, foods with a high GI are those which are rapidly digested and absorbed. This results in a yo-yo effect in the blood sugar levels. Low GI foods are digested and absorbed in a gradual way. This produces a much more even rise in blood sugar and insulin levels. Now, research has proven this much more beneficial to the health of those with diabetes. Low GI diets have been shown to improve both glucose and lipid levels in people with diabetes, both type 1 and type 2. Weight can be controlled much better with a low GI diet. Low GI foods are absorbed slowly, which helps keep you fuller longer. The impact on your blood sugar is minimal, and you will see a reduction in insulin levels and insulin resistance. Now, recent studies from the Harvard School of Public Health indicate that the risk of type 2 diabetes and coronary heart disease are strongly related to the GI of the overall diet. The World Health Organization and Food Agriculture Organization recommends that people in industrialized countries base their diets on low GI foods in order to prevent the most common diseases of affluence, such as coronary heart disease, diabetes, and obesity. Now, I found it very interesting how a GI value for a particular food is determined. According to the GI website, quote, to determine a food's GI value, measured portions of the food containing 50 grams of available carbohydrate or 25 grams of available carbohydrate for foods that contain lower amounts of carbs are fed to 10 healthy people after an overnight fast. Finger prick blood samples are taken at 15 to 30 minute intervals over the next 2 hours. These blood samples are used to construct a blood sugar response curve for the 2 hour period. The incremental area under the curve is calculated to reflect the total rise in blood glucose levels after eating the test food. The GI value is calculated by dividing the IAUC for the test food by the IUAC for the reference food, the same amount of glucose, and then multiplying by 100. Now, the chart on your screen may make that a little bit more clearer. There is now a push by some to have terms like sugars and complex carbs be removed from the nutritional label and replaced with total carbs, that's carbs minus dietary fiber, and glycemic index. The main problem with this concept is that there are very few places who conduct legitimate GI calculations. The Human Nutrition Unit at the University of Sydney has been at the forefront of glycemic research for over 2 decades and has tested hundreds of foods as an integral part of its program. Now, if you watched any of my videos at all, you know that I'm an advocate of the glycemic load rather than just the glycemic index. The glycemic index basically only tells us how quickly a food is digested and gets into the bloodstream. But the glycemic load takes into consideration every component of the food as a whole. It tells us much more about how the food will affect our blood sugar overall. With glycemic load, the numbers are a bit different. Foods with a GL of 10 and below are considered low GL. Foods with a GL between 11 and 19 are considered medium GL, and foods with a 20 GL or more is a high GL food. Now, because the glycemic load of a food looks at the food as a whole and not just the carbs, the same food can have a high GI but an overall low GL, making it better for you than it originally might have appeared. Take watermelon, for example. If you looked at the GI of watermelon, you wouldn't eat it at all. Why? Well, it depends on the type melon, actually, but the GI of watermelon can be between 70 and 95. So you are told, as one with diabetes, you can't eat that. Its GI is way too high. There's too much sugar. But the glycemic load of watermelon is between 4 and 6. It has very little impact on blood sugar. So you might not have considered watermelon on the basis of GI, but the GL is so low, it's a great summertime snack. And I was very pleased to see the following on the GI website. Quote, glycemic load, or GL, combines both the quality and quantity of carbohydrate in one number. It's the best way to predict blood glucose values of different types and amounts of food. Now that really made me feel well. It validates my hypothesis on the GL. Now the formula to calculate GL is very simple. You take the GI, multiply the amount of total carbs divided by 100. Now the amount of carbs, the total carbs, is that minus dietary fiber. You take the carbs minus the dietary fiber, and this is also specific to an amount of food. So let's do a calculation for example. You're told as a person with diabetes you shouldn't eat white bread. Well, let's look at this. The GI of Wonder Bread is 70. That's a high GI food. One slice of Wonder Bread has 15 carbs, one dietary fiber. So our formula would be 70, which is the GI, times 14, that's 15 minus 1, divided by 100. This equals 9.8. Wonder Bread has very little impact on your blood sugar. A slice of Wonder Bread can be wonderful for you. Now I hope this has shed light on the glycemic index and possibly a little more about the glycemic load as well. Don't forget to get my new ebook. And please subscribe to our channel for many more videos like this one in the future. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Ty Mason.